Welcome to Connecting the Dots, a laser-focused quick-fire interview on the food and the economy with international experts where we seek answers to questions all of us should be asking. I'm Ajay Jakhar, Chairman Bharat Krishik Samaj, Farmers Forum India, a farmers organization based in India. Today, we are excited because with us is Seth Itsekan, an environmental futurist investigating innovative means of land management that offer hope for reviving global warming issues. Seth is the co-founder of Soil for Climate, which advocates for soil restoration as a climate solution, and also is the president of Planet Tech Associates, a consultancy focusing on trends and innovations. Thank you, Seth, for joining us today.
Thank you, AJ. It's a pleasure to be on the Connecting the Dots show with you.
The first question would be, how did you get interested and inspired in the debate around livestock and animal-sourced foods? How does your training and studies for the future help you in your work?
Okay, well, first of all, I also just want to say that I am delighted to be here and to be on the show, and I do consider it a great honor, and you're doing a good service by having the show, and thank you for that. It is an interesting sort of evolution as to how I got to this spot. I would say my upbringing was typical of sort of a liberal intellectual upbringing. And I, of course, was interested in environmental issues from the time I was young. You know, my parents were intellectuals interested in environmental issues. And climate, of course, was an issue. I've been interested in the climate issue since it's been an issue, since the earliest times. And what's interesting is that from my perspective, I sort of break it down into sort of three phases. The first phase was simply even acknowledging that it is real. All right. The second phase is then knowing that we have to take action to reduce the emissions. And that's still sort of the predominant bulk of the climate movement. But now there's a third phase, which is realizing that there's already too much carbon in the atmosphere and we have to take it out. Okay, so that's sort of the third phase, that we have to get to what we would call the drawdown phase of actually taking the carbon out of the atmosphere. And I felt as if the first two phases were being covered fairly well. The 350.org organization was really making the point that we have to reduce emissions, and there was efforts toward, you know, electric vehicles, and people kind of got that, people who weren't in denial at any rate. But the message that's still being missed, even by the mainstream climate movement, is that we have to take carbon out of the air. So I began getting interested in that around 2010, 2009, something like that. And then it's like, well, how are you gonna do that? How are you gonna take carbon out of the air? And it turns out that putting it in soil is sort of the natural thing. It's sort of what nature wants to do. It's what's called the sink, or a biological sink. It's also called a terrestrial sink. And it turns out that most of the soil carbon is in grasslands or former grasslands or agricultural lands. It has been depleted over millennia, really, for thousands of years. And it turns out that grazing, in the way that nature intended, is how it got there in the first place. You know, that's how the soils got carbon rich, was through the co-evolution of these massive herds of ruminants. And so a practice has evolved called holistic grazing, holistic plan grazing, holistic management, other generic terms like regenerative grazing, or now in the scientific literature, it's called AMP grazing. I know you had a question on that. But basically, it's grazing of domestic ruminants, but in a fashion which is a proxy of how the wild herd would behave. And basically that means a more dense pack and more frequent movements. And the soil carbon increases from that have been impressive. And so this for me is hopeful. And so that's why I'm in that space now. Now, in terms of the future side of it, well, futurism is sort of a generic term for trying to look at scenarios or trends. And you know, I prefer to look at a hopeful scenario or trend as opposed to, you know, a gloomy one. And this is the one which for me gives me hope, because land restoration is really one of the more, you know, hopeful things. And when you see it, when you literally see land that has been restored, it's just profound. I mean, it changes you on the inside. And so that's sort of like how I got to be where I am today with the organization is called Soil for Climate.
That's really inspiring. You have advocated that livestock sector may not have to be reduced at all, but rather changed. That's what you're telling us, to be environmentally sustainable. However, land, especially those that were originally grasslands or savanna, is finite resource, while human population growth and meat consumption is rising every year rapidly. In such a scenario, would regenerative or holistic grazing be able to meet the demand for animal products in a sustainable manner? Why I ask this question is because this is what generally people ask who are propagating for industrial farming, as if to, you know, say that alternatives don't work.
Right. So my position is that regenerative grazing is the only practice that will simultaneously produce protein for 8 billion people and also draw down the carbon necessary to avert a climate catastrophe. You see, we're already in a position where there's too much carbon in the air. You see, so even if we literally just stopped everything today, did not emit another gram of CO2, we're still already, you know, on a type of, you know, death spiral with the carbon that's already in the air. So it has to come out. And so we need to do regenerative grazing to restore the soil, to build these carbon sinks, whether we need food or not. You see, this is a climate emergency. We have to take the carbon out of the air. We have to restore the grasslands. And it approximately works out. There's about 10 billion acres of depleted soil. There's roughly 300 billion tons of excess carbon in the atmosphere. That would work out to about 30 tons per acre, which is doable. I mean, the regenerative grazing practices have demonstrated that. And so, I mean, look, we're in a desperate situation. I'm not saying this is easy or trivial or that everything's going to be fine and I know all the answers, but I'm just saying this is something we have to do anyway. And it more or less works out and you get protein. I mean, that is sort of the outcome of restoring this land with this grazing practice and sequestering the carbon is the protein. That is the outcome. Now, the question is, well, will there be enough? I think it will be, because I think the densities can be much greater than we currently employ, because we're not grazing properly. We are grazing with low density management, and I actually think it can be greater. Now, the industrial livestock model, which finishes animals on grain, just to be clear, it just finishes them on grain. So they come to weight quicker. There aren't necessarily more of them. It's still the same amount of animals, excuse me. But they would just be managed in an entirely different way. So just to be clear, we absolutely are not advocating for the grain approach to livestock management, but we're not advocating for a reduction of livestock either. We're saying we need those same animals to be employed, if you will, in service of soil restoration. Now there are some interesting nuances here. And this is that sort of has to do with chickens and pigs, for example. Chickens and pigs are predominantly in an industrial situation. And they live predominantly on the grain agriculture. Now, the cows, sheep, and goats don't. Cows, sheep, and goats can eat grass. So I actually see a transition away from chicken and pigs toward cows, sheep, and goats. And what's interesting is that the sort of plant-based movement or the sort of eat less red meat movement, I actually think it'll be the opposite. I actually think there's going to be less white meat and more red meat, because the red meat can live on the grass and the white meat, meaning like the chicken, has to be fed grain. So, and as you and I were talking before, you know, nothing just happens overnight. Obviously, these are have to be slow shifts, but the shift that I see taking hold is the one where we value soil. And when you value soil, you're going to say, okay, well, how can I improve the soil carbon? And you say, let me think about that. Say, oh, I know, with regenerative grazing. So you just start to do the regenerative grazing. And then as the soil gets better, you get more plants, you can say, well, you know, I can support more animals now. So in terms of the total of what's possible, no, I don't know what the total is. But I'm optimistic it can be certainly as much as now, if not even more. So let me just leave it at that.
That's a very interesting perspective. I think so the audience which is looking at this interview will really like this differentiation that you have given. I mean, it's something very new for me, and thank you for that. Which gets me to a concept. You have a concept with drawdown and AMP, adaptive multi-pattern grazing. Can you explain that to a lay audience? What role do they play in a holistic management practices?
Sure. Well, just to be clear, those aren't my concepts. Drawdown is sort of a generic concept, but in this context, it means to draw down the carbon that's in the atmosphere. Unfortunately, it also has come to mean, and I think inappropriately, to draw down the amount of pollution that you're adding. So like to pollute less. That's not okay. The intended meaning of that word. It was meant to mean literally to draw down, like literally, the carbon that was in the atmosphere into the ground. Okay, so anyway, in that context, that then obviously, you know, is germane for soil for climate. In regards to the AMP grazing, so AMP is an acronym and it stands for adaptive multi-paddock grazing. So let's just break that down for a little bit. Adaptive obviously means sort of you can be flexible. It's not a fixed schedule. You can change depending on the circumstances. Multi-paddock is the key phrase here because in a paddock, first of all, just means sort of the area where the animals are grazing. And in a traditional grazing scheme, there really aren't that many paddocks. There may only be one. And the animals are just sort of spread out. The idea of the regenerative grazing is to have more smaller paddocks, get the animals closer together and have them be in each paddock for a shorter amount of time. And some practitioners are saying you need like 20 or 30 paddocks to really have that restorative results and to really replicate the type of herd behavior where the animals really are close together and always moving. So in literature, in the scientific literature now, you'll see the term AMP grazing, AMP, or adaptive multi-paddock. And that's the type of grazing which will give you the drawdown that we talked about before. And of course, then that's all part of the soil for climate mission, if you will, of using soil as a climate solution. And just to be clear, we don't only advocate for grazing. I mean, there are other practices as well. For example, there's cover crops, no-till, organic, not using fertilizer. There's something called biochar, which is a form of low oxygen combustion, basically creating charcoal that will hold the carbon for all practical purposes forever. I mean, for thousands of years. And so look up biochar. So we advocate for all of that. It just so happens that grazing is the practice that's most applicable on most of the earth that's in some sort of agricultural or quasi-agricultural system. And because it's controversial, that's kind of like where everyone wants to talk about. But that's not the only practice that we endorse. We endorse any practice that builds soil carbon, including things like silvopasture that you and I were talking about before, agroforestry. There are other practices.
Thank you for that. But it's Seth, it's funny because, not even funny, it's sad actually, because the public research system is not looking and researching into all this. They're still stuck into their old mindset, and I don't know how they're going to change. But which anyway gets me to the next question, which is industrial animal agriculture is the dominant method of meat production in high-income countries whose adverse impact expands to countries in the global south, where monocultures of soy and corn are cultivated for animal feed that is ultimately exported. Meat consumption in the West also exceeds nutritionally recommended levels, while children in the global south miss out on the benefits of animal protein for their growth and development. Do you need to address the geographical imbalances in meat production and consumption? And you think, is that possible? Do you advocate for compensating this imbalance?
Oh, yes, of course. I mean, the imbalance, there are many imbalances between the global north and south, and they're all need to be rectified. But the solution is not less meat. The solution is better meat production, regenerative meat production in the global south. And that's what Soil for Climate is working on. We have a program in Kenya right now that we're working on. We're working on the Maasai lands there. To help improve the soil and to have them be viable, producing meat for them for themselves, a healthy regenerative meat. Basically, what's happened is that, let's just say the global north or the developed world developed the industrial grain-based model, and then they sort of exported it or imposed it on the global south. And obviously that's a problem. But what we're saying is that we don't need to do any of that, that there's enough land for each area to produce, to be producing its own food in a regenerative way. So it goes without saying that turning a savanna or a semi dry land ecosystem into soy for export for cattle in China or, you know, the United States is horrifying. We stand shoulder to shoulder with the advocates who are against that. But then what we advocate for will be slightly different. They'll might just say, oh, well, we need less meat. And I'll say, no, not necessarily. We need to just be making it differently. Then there's also, there's a sort of a second question there, which is sort of implied that somehow if us in the North, global North, eat less, then somehow there's more in the South. I don't necessarily see the math for that. I think each region can be producing its own. And I think once there's a value on soil and soil carbon, they will. But it goes without saying, and we absolutely stand shoulder to shoulder with our colleagues who are against, for example, the catastrophe in Brazil. You know, cutting down the Amazon rainforest to make soy is a catastrophe, and we absolutely stand against that.
Thank you for that advocacy. And you have often highlighted the importance of understanding the nuances and diversity in ecology, climate, and soil systems across the world. The question is, how do you think this in-depth understanding can be incorporated in the climate change advocacy and communicated successfully to the larger public? Because what we see is there are polarized positions, and we need to find a middle path and get people to make that transformative change.
Right. And, you know, as you and I were talking about earlier, you know, things don't happen overnight. And if you advocate for an overnight profound change, it will just backfire. You know, you need to make these realistic incremental steps. And that's why we say focus on the soil. You see, when you focus on the soil, it's an outcome-based advocacy. It's not a practice-based advocacy, excuse me. So yes, I'm saying that regenerative grazing, that is a practice, but it's only a practice that I'll advocate for as long as the outcomes are verified. And if you can verify a beneficial outcome to soil by doing something else, then go for it. You know, do it. And so I don't want to be part of the polarized discussion of meat versus non-meat or this versus that. I say, let's build soil in a way that also produces food and protein. and let's see what happens. You know, let's yeah. see what we can do. Now, the summit, of course, the UN Food Systems, well, I don't know if we've mentioned that yet, but so the UN Food Systems Summit is going on now. I'm honored to be part of that. There is a group within it, or they call it a sustainable cluster, called the Sustainable Livestock Cluster. And I'm honored to have contributed to a paper in that. So AJ, if you can, you know, refer your viewers to the Sustainable Livestock Solution Cluster within the UN Food Systems Summit. There are three papers that cluster produced. I'm a co-author of paper B. It's called Grazing for Soil, Carbon, and People, or something like that. I don't see the title in front of me right now, but it's basically the paper that advocates for regenerative grazing. So that's the UN Food Systems Summit is an important vehicle for this. Your show, your Connecting the Dots show, is an important vehicle for this. The Soil for Climate Facebook group, of course, is an important vehicle for this. And there's a whole regenerative grazing and regenerative agriculture movement. I mean, if you just Google on regenerative grazing or regenerative agriculture, there's a lot of groups. Kiss the Ground movie. Oh, let me put in a plug for that. And that would be another, those producers would be another group for you to interview for your show. The movie's called Kiss the Ground. So, you know, it's a growing movement. I'm not naive to think that, you know, overnight, you know, the world's just going to switch, you know, on a dime, on a pin. But I believe that this is the appropriate path to take.
Well, I'll be putting up that link for the article, and also look forward to being connected with people you think should be interviewed on Connecting the Dots. Which gets us to the last question, Seth, which is, what are you looking forward to in let's say in the next few years? What are you looking forward to?
So there's a couple of things that I'm optimistic about. I'll start sort of simple and then get, you know, sort of grand. There's something called Healthy Soils Legislation, and Soil for Climate has a website that tracks the Healthy Soils Legislation in the United States. So it's just a US-based site for now, but that URL is just policy.soilforclimate.org. And Soil for Climate is just a word soil, the number four, and then the word climate.org. So policy.soilforclimate.org. And you can see the list of the healthy soils legislative policies that have been filed at the state level in the United States. It's not even complete. That's a good sign that even when I bring it up to date, then it's already out of date because there's more stuff is happening so quickly. And I am really optimistic about this because, again, it's not prescriptive. It doesn't say what to do. It's outcomes based. It says, are you improving the soil carbon, water infiltration, the amount of land that's not in tillage? There's a program with the National Audubon Society, I think, called, I apologize, I'm blanking on the name right now, but basically where they're working with grazers to improve the quality of the land for the nesting birds. So the birds that nest on the land, you know, there's a whole set of birds that depend on healthy pasture for that. And so the National Audubon Society is actually working with grazers to graze in a way that maintains the land for the birds. So they're actually like counting the birds, you know, so that's like a specific outcome, like literally how many birds are there? That's what I like about these programs. They're not practice-based, they're outcome-based. And so I'm encouraged by the move toward healthy soils legislation. And just sort of, from a visionary point of view, I look forward to seeing large parts of the world that are today desertified or trending toward desertification to reverse that trend and become healthy soil again. I mean, honestly, for me, at an emotional level, that really is the most important thing. I mean, I have stood in grass, you know, this high in an area where 10 years prior, it was desert, you know, and I've got pictures of this type on my website. And then, you know, I've pulled out the grass and you can see all the good clumpy soil and the little worms and everything in there. And you're like, yeah, you know, like that's victory right there. And if you could do that times 10 billion, you know, well, you know, then there's hope.
Your enthusiasm and energy is contagious. Yes, it's inspiring. Thank you so much for this. Thank you so much for this interview. And we look forward to, you know, visiting these grasslands with you sometime, you know, to get to see this for ourselves, because this is miraculous. If you look at it, people won't believe it. Those who've not seen this, you know, nature rejuvenate itself. Thank you so much, Seth, for your interview. Thank you so much for your time, and looking forward to staying connected.
Thank you, AJ. It's my pleasure.